Good evening, good evening. It's fantastic to see so many people here tonight. My name is Matthew Dobson, and I'm the head of awards here at the RIBA. Thank you all for coming. Stirling Stories is in its fifth year, and every year seems to be much more popular than last, and this really has been a record sellout crowd, extra seating at the back. It's fantastic to have so much interest in the prize and in the stories behind the fantastic buildings that we're going to consider tonight. As you probably know, the Stirling Prize winner itself will be announced here on October the 6th, and I'm contractually obliged to say that tickets are still available, but they are selling fast, so do take the opportunity to book yourself a place if you can. And Stirling Stories, I suppose this event really marks the beginning of the countdown to the event itself. Each of the buildings that we're going to hear about tonight has been through several rounds of judging to make it down to the final six from the original 535 entries that we received back in February. And I hope that tonight we'll be able to gain some insights from the architects into just what makes these buildings so special. To help us do that, our chair this evening is Simon Alford of AHMM, winners of last year's Stirling Prize for the Burntwood School. And before I ask Simon to introduce our six speakers and our six projects, could I just remind you all to switch your phones to silent, but not to switch them off, because we would strongly encourage you to use the hashtag Stirling Prize that you see there on the screen. I'd also say that after the event tonight, drinks will be served upstairs in the Florence Hall, so do join us after we've heard from all our speakers. There will also be a chance to ask questions yourselves of our panelists and presenters tonight. So I very much hope to see you at the Stirling ceremony a month from today. Do look out on the RIBA website for details of how to buy tickets. There again, fulfilling contractual obligations again. And I'll hand over to Simon. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. A magnificently full room. It's often asked, how important is the Stirling Prize? Well, a lot of you will have been involved in judging it or had buildings on the shortlist for it or whatever. It's very important because it's shown by the fact that you're all here. You're interested. If you've been on the shortlist, you know that you always defend yourself in these situations by saying it's really about getting on the list. It's not about winning. That's a random event, etc., etc., etc. And I think in a way that is true. The Stirling Prize is about a celebration of excellence, the best, the most intriguing, the most challenging architecture. Different juries on different days, despite the thoroughness of the process in which I'm involved, would choose different shortlists, and different juries on different days would choose different winners. That is kind of the appropriate relevance of subjectivity. So it's a celebration of architecture. It's important. It's shown that it's important by the fact that the bookies are heavily involved in it with different odds, and everyone here in this room will probably know their odds. And the tip is to bet against yourself, offset the pain of losing. What does it mean to win? I think it's an imprimatur, it's a stamp, it's an acknowledgement that you must be doing something in the very difficult world we inhabit, something that's right, that's celebrated, that's clever, that's survived the Exocet missiles of building a project that might take 10 years to come through, that might involve numerous battles. I'm going to ask each of the six practices to talk to you for 10 minutes. Afterwards, they'll come on the panel and onto the stage and we'll have a few questions. So I'm keen to kind of get some engagement going with you. But just to give you an idea of what this is about, they will introduce themselves, but there are six projects, seven practices, four nationalities, if you include the principality as a nationality. And I know Chris is working hard to bring Wales forward in the world of architectural debate and discussion. There are three winners, three previous winners. One of the practices won it twice. And there are nine shortlists amongst these six, and there's one novice. So it's a wide range, different scales of practices, working in different localities, different kinds of projects over different timelines. So it's an incredibly diverse thing, and that's what architecture is. So I would end there just to say that it's really great to see you all, and I invite our first speaker from Herzog de Meuron to come up and introduce himself.
Thank you, Simon. It's a great pleasure to be here and to be able to present this School of Government, Blavatnik School of Government. It has been a fantastic project for us, a really deep experience with the client, with the contractor, with the City of Oxford, and I will try my best to bring across this experience in 10 minutes. The 10 minutes is not so much the issue. The issue was that you said we should restrict ourselves to 15 slides, which is a much bigger issue. I didn't succeed, but I think I deleted too many slides, so I will try to speak now to few slides in 10 minutes. When the client approached us, this was their statement, and I read it because it's kind of important. The Blavatnik School of Government will become a global center of excellence for the study of government and public policy. The school's aim is to teach the practice of government and leadership in ways which will strengthen communities, create opportunities, and foster cooperation across the world. Of course, there's a lot of heaviness to this, and not all of it is so important, but there was one thing which really struck us, which is the idea of strengthening communities, create opportunities, and foster cooperation, that this really could become a theme for a school, and that that theme would basically drive the entire teaching process. Teaching has changed tremendously in the last years, and especially when it's about government policies. I think these three aspects, cooperation, collaboration, community, social exchange, is extremely important to bring together the different cultures, to understand these cultures, and to work with that. So we made that the theme of our project. The other context was given by the city. Oxford is, of course, for us, coming from Switzerland, a quite beautiful and shocking experience at the same time. It's so complete, so nice, and so many interesting buildings which you typically only know from movies. And we were really fascinated by these colleges and the courtyards in the colleges and how they really kind of provide a social space. But then again, they don't. You know, it's too cold, too rainy, too windy, and people don't stay there to just go through as quickly as possible to go in their little room upstairs or downstairs. So they kind of fail as this communal space, and we felt that's an interesting aspect. The other spaces we were really thrilled with were, of course, the halls. They don't fail. They are very successful. They're very social. They're very animated. They're very lively. They're really stunning spaces, stunning interiors. But you really only go there for eating and a few other activities. But it's not the place where you know, form a new work group or exchange about political ideas and so on. But there's something very grand about these spaces, and I think what we wanted to do is to bring these things together. So when the courtyard is the circulation space and when the hall is the meeting space, that together would create the forum space, and that would form the heart of the entire project. That was the idea. Forum. You think of the Roman Senate, it's like the urform, so to say, of government, so, all in a circle. And this has been the role model for basically all governmental buildings, except the British one, of course. But typically, you sit together in a round and you discuss these things together. So I think it's a very important aspect, and that was driving our decision. So as a first, almost like immediate reaction, we said we would place all the teaching faculty spaces, staff spaces around this central space, literally create this ring of boxes stacked on top of each other. which would then result in this interior space which really would bring everything together, like around a campfire. You know, everybody would circulate around this central space, and that would really become the nucleus of all activities, with very different spatial qualities, dramatic areas, more intimate areas, but at the end of the day, everybody will find a place, a nook, a niche, or also a larger surface around the central space. But there's also another driving factor in Oxford, which is this extreme rigor in geometry and composition. When you look at the existing buildings in the historic Oxford city fabric, it's astonishing how these buildings are composed, how precise they are located on the site. Even the landscaping is playing an important role in that. And we felt that we want to continue this fabric onto the new site, which has really been part of the historic Oxford, but new, empty, basically, and planned with a, you could say, generic master plan. This is the master plan by another international architect, and you don't really feel that this is part of Oxford. And we had the opportunity to work within this master plan on that site, within that massing and volume envelope. And what we found out is basically at the end of the day, when you arrive by train, for example, or when you arrive from the to the campus, this is the first building you will encounter of this new campus. So we felt it's very important that we are an object rather than a block, that we allow the people to flow around the building rather than blocking the access into the site. So we came up with this very precise stack of circles, most of them circles, with one exception, which is the first one, which is the horseshoe following the street. Very important because it introduces a scale for the people, it introduces a relationship to the neighboring buildings, it kind of creates an intimate entrance, and we still have them with the upper volume overhanging above this thing, create this big two-story entrance, which is also so important in most of Oxford historic buildings and projects. For us, it was also, that was one of the biggest struggles we had with our client, independent client, Blavatnik. I have to tell one little story. He was a fantastic client. He always asked the right questions. He was very critical, very smart, very precise. But he has this one thing going on with the grand entrance. Yeah. And the grand entrance for us, of course, was always counterintuitive. We didn't want to do a two-story entrance. So with this solution of introducing this window to the world, as we call it, which is like a gathering space on the inside of the building, we create a double-story entrance without building really a double-story door. On the inside, this stacking has a different logic. It's much more free, but it's still around the same circle. It forms the central space. The discs are now allowing for different spatial experience, and everything is connected vertically from the lowest floor to the highest floor to the sky. You always have this cross vista and the vista through the building. You have teaching spaces with windows, filtered windows, but screened windows to the forum space, but you also have more like meeting room-like spaces, small formal breakout spaces or informal niches where you can meet. So you have every scale, every different ingredient, so to say, you need in a contemporary learning environment. But everything is still around this one space. It really forms literally a community, so to say. For the individual meeting opportunities, you can use the central forum space as well as, and that's very important, it can really become a huge lecture theater, really like a forum for music, for concerts, or for openings, or for other events, but basically it can be used in a much grander scale as well. That was important. The materiality is wood and concrete and glass, nothing else, and very often the concrete is defining the space. The concrete, like in the old buildings, where you have the stone, the Oxford limestone, not only on the exterior of the buildings, but also on the interior. In our case, the concrete is on the interior of the building. So we were looking for a reconstituted stone, so to say. We would not use the Oxford limestone, but we would use a concrete which mimics the texture, the color, the feel of the limestone in a very different way, but on one hand relates to it. And we build mock-ups of that, many to match the color and to understand how these things come together. And what used to be a stone skin is now a very technical skin. And we have a double skin facade, we have a protection for the sunshades, we have ventilation protected from the outer skin, and we have the possibility of an acoustic insulation, which is also very important. So suddenly, something which is very much in line with the historic architecture of Oxford becomes a very contemporary building. Something which very much plays with these connotations is at the same time very much of our times today. And it's not a pastiche, it's not a cliché, it's very contemporary. And it still fits in the oval fabric. Thank you. That was 10 minutes.
Right, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. To my left is Lyle Christie of Reagan Hall Architects, and I'm Brendan Diamond of Michael Laird Architects. And you're probably thinking, why two, or even how two? Basically, at the very start of the project, we got together to form a single team to design and deliver this project from the very start. We had actually worked together and collaborated on bids, and we realized we quite like each other and that we could work together. And with our skills in design in large buildings and Reagan Hall's and unrivaled skills in design and college projects, it was a marriage made in heaven, and so it proved. We actually have a very similar ethos, and we only live 100 meters away from each other in Edinburgh, and so actually we always actually co-locate it in one office for this project. The project, we always tried to put the students at the very heart of every decision that we took. The City of Glasgow College is a maritime and engineering college, and it actually attracts a wide variety of students. It attracts 16-year-olds from all over the world to do a variety of courses, and adults who actually want to become grand mariners and chief engineers and captains. So it's a wide variation. So we wanted to create an inspirational environment, a really truly inspirational environment, where every square inch of space in the building was a flexible space for teaching and for learning. Glasgow, for those of you that don't know it, way up there. We wanted Glasgow to be at the heart of our design, but we actually wanted the build to be in the Glasgow to be part of our building design as well. So we actually spent a lot of time actually thinking about the college itself. And City of Glasgow College was a super campus, which was the amalgamation of three colleges, you'll see up in there. It was actually on two sites, the Riverside campus, which we're talking about this evening, and the City campus, which is getting completed at the minute. The Riverside campus is on the south edge of the city with a strong grid pattern. It's right on the banks of the River Clyde. Now, for decades, the buildings along the River Clyde have either pulled away or turned its back on the Clyde, and we made a conscious effort not to make that same mistake. It's also beside Glasgow Green, which is probably the equivalent of Hyde Park in Glasgow, pushing it a bit. It's also beside the Gorbals, and for those of you who know Glasgow, then it's not without its economic and social challenges. It's also on a very key sort of access route into the site and therefore forms a gateway from the south into the city. The process, I'll just very quickly talk about it, because surprisingly this project was actually procured through the modern Scottish equivalent of the PFI process, which is still running in Scotland. And so basically it was a design and build competition that we had. And we had to tie up with a contractor, in this case the Robert McAlpines, from the very, very start. And as it was design and build, and it was a bid, we actually had to wow the City of Glasgow College from the very start with our design, but we also had to make it as efficient and as cost-effective as possible. The whole process lasted about 8 months, where actually a team of five or six were all whittled down to two, and those two had to create a Stage E design. So this was a detailed design competition. So actually, although we were glad to win, you know, in my humble and our humble opinion, while we're glad to have done it and it was good value for the Scottish public, it was a horrendous waste of effort for the construction industry, especially the losing architects.
So taking those ideas that Brendan spoke about with the student and the fantastically endowed site, we started to tease into how we might prepare and bring the city into the college, as well as take the students from the college to the city. This is a model of a concept that we had about an enlivened circulation that has got a diverse series of spaces, very similar. There's lots of themes here that, dramatically different expression, but lots of themes that, you'll hear the same. So looking at the site, it is approached from the north across the Clyde, from the city centre, or from the south from the Gorbals, as Brendan mentioned. We chose to place the main building immediately against the Clyde at some considerable scale for that locality to act as a gatekeeper, to mark that threshold. It has fantastic views in all directions once you get anywhere above the first floor. There's also halls of residence as part of the project, and the visitors to the halls are generally not from Britain. So we wanted to give them a spot on the Clyde where they would have elevated views to the city. They can make a mental map and find their way home if they get lost in the city, but also just to enjoy that aspect. We placed the low engineering building to the south so that sunlight can get into the beautiful gardens that it hardly ever rains in Scotland. we carved out a grand room as a place for the college community to exist out of the main engineering building, education building. The ground floor is entirely permeable, though, so you can meander through the site in the daylight hours. At night time, some of the students that are in the halls are 16 and there's a duty of care, so it gets locked down at night, as a park in a city does. We chose to take the brief, which is maritime, engineering, and science faculty, and muddle that up. So each of those colours is a different piece of the brief. And that was because of an idea about blended learning. Again, that's one of those education themes. And gathered all of that together in a single drawing. I think this is the drawing that actually helped us win, where the grand room properly engages with the Clyde and the city. And from that space, which is an invitation into the building and a view out of the building to the city, acts as a place for the community of the college to exist. This space is the organizing heart of the building, but also it's a place where it can have its community. Created a diversity of place around that space so that you can do group learning or individual learning, but always trying to put the education on display so that if you're a student at this college and you see something that interests you, you feel empowered to go and join in. We understand the learning experience for the students in FE colleges is as much social as didactic, so immediately beside that space, this is social learning on the left, the breakout from the library, and the refectory on the right. These are only a few paces away from that grand room. A few further paces, and you start to enter the world of the engineering hall. This is a classroom like none you've ever seen before. This space was originally briefed as a series of separate individual rooms. We took that brief and bumped them all together, opened them up so that the students that are in there learning different types of engineering can all learn from each other. But always, with every space, engage these beautiful, sunlit, friendly gardens that we've made. There are really dramatically complicated pieces of machinery in the building as well. There's a working ship's engine. This is a shipping simulation suite. So you can learn to pilot a major shipping vessel to any port in the world. This one's Venice that happens to be going into today. We also wanted to try and use the building as a learning tool itself. So the exposure of the concrete and the steel and the ceiling-mounted services is a very deliberate idea because there are students here who'll be learning how to design and make these things. Always with that view back to the city and the view in from the city so that Glaswegians are very deliberately invited to join in with this building. The halls of residence engages with the garden. An issue that might be worth mentioning is the FE sector is sometimes a little bit downplayed in relation to HE, so we deliberately adopted the classical idiom of the walled garden to give it a bit of stature and gravitas. The living spaces of the halls all have corner views with elevated views to the city.
Externally, the building was given a very, very simple palette of materials, really three. At the ground floor, there was an embossed white concrete colonnade, which actually gives the building a sort of a public and human scale. There's the bronzed unitized glazing above it and infill panels of bronzed corrugated aluminium. So very, very simple palette, but all arranged in a simple grid, which was specifically redolent of the 19th century Glasgow modular cast iron facades that were being built actually at the same time as Chicago. As you can see, the building succeeds very much as a gateway building, but also we believe it succeeded in getting the tailored civic expression that we wanted very hard to try to achieve. It also succeeded very well in its relationship to the Clyde. There's a walkway along the Clyde called the Riverside Walkway. There's bits of it you wouldn't walk on at night, but we actually believe in the 1 year that this building's been open, that has actually dramatically improved the safety and the environs of that walkway. And in summary, the building has succeeded as a building for the student and has the users of the building at its heart. I mean, since it's opened, the City of Glasgow College has attracted even more international sponsorship from merchant shipping companies. But I think the most important bit, I think it has raised the expectations of the students themselves. The building provides a scale and a quality and an ambition, and I think that the students haven't experienced before. And anecdotally, because the results aren't all in yet, the results and the attendance in the college have actually improved since they moved in. So we're very pleased with the building, and in the short time and the very limited budget that we had to create this building, I think we have created an exciting new landmark for Glasgow. Thank you.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Peter St. John. I'm partner of Caruso St. John Architects in London. We're the architects for the Newport Street Gallery in Vauxhall in South London, which we designed for the artist Damien Hirst, a building to show his collection of contemporary art. And I think the ideas of the project and how to approach the way of reusing existing buildings came from things that Adam and I did at the beginning of the 90s when we were starting our practice, a time in London when there was a recession, also a time when Damien Hirst and other artists emerged as a force in London. And we were wandering around the city, sort of taking stock, I would say, taking some rather average photographs of buildings that we found in London. We were enjoying London for what we felt was its loose, organic character of rather ordinary architecture that actually made very comfortable streets to live in. And we were looking at found things, like, for example, this factory building in Clerkenwell, which subsequently became a showroom for Christie's and then actually an architect's office, but was disused at this time. And we were looking at these buildings, that we rather enjoyed for their rather extraordinary mass, a building here that is sort of going up as well as going down at the same time. And we were looking at these existing buildings, kind of asking ourselves why we found them quite impressive and emotionally quite strong, kind of character that we couldn't see in contemporary architecture. And at the time we were working in Adam's home, which he made in a little warehouse in Islington. This is the back of it. And inside, we didn't paint the walls. We added a few new materials. There was a power-floated concrete floor, which 25 years ago was rather an advanced piece of technology, some unpainted skimmed plasterboard. We were trying to balance new and old materials here. And I think the project was a sort of microcosm of what we liked about London, a city in which you don't feel you have to start from scratch. You don't even feel you have to finish, but instead you're participating in something which is ongoing, and it's less clear what is past and what is present. I think that idea is emblematic of our project at Newport Street. And at Newport Street, we were working with three listed buildings. They're scenery painting and scenery constructing studios from 1913. These three buildings in the middle of the street, which we liked for their very sheer, tall elevations with these rather face-like facades with big foreheads. And we demolished the low building on the left and the little warehouse on the right, where we made new buildings in order to make a new street out of this collection of buildings. And they were extraordinary interiors. This is one of the scenery painting studios, which is 15 meters high, goes down into the basement. You can see the walls are very thin brick, stiffened by this brick pier structure. Very beautiful spaces, but not of the proportion that would be suitable to make gallery spaces. So in the project, you can see here a model with the new building on the left and a new building on the right and three existing buildings in the middle. We placed a new floor in across joining all the buildings at 8 meters up, just above the level of the clerestory windows in the existing building, to make 7 meter high galleries on the ground floor and 4.5 meter high galleries upstairs. And then on the left-hand side, maybe I can point, there's a staircase here and a staircase buried in the building here, so that you can walk down the galleries and up the stair and back to the galleries to make a loop. And there's a stair in the middle if you wanted to make a smaller loop of a smaller collection of gallery spaces. And on the right-hand side here is a little office building for Damien Hirst's organization that runs the collection, and a viewing room on the top floor. And here, we made a little bridge to join these two floors. And with this working model, see, we made a little building on the left-hand side with this Northlight roof structure, and the office building on the right-hand side also had a balcony here to the viewing room and a roof terrace where the artist can put large sculptures on the roof of the building. And the idea was to make the faces and the tops of these buildings quite lively and different, sort of picking up on the fact that these buildings had different tops, but exaggerating it, sort of taking the latent idea of what we found, but making it something that is much more noticeable, something that might then catch your attention or even make you smile a little bit. This is the plan of the ground floor, showing that you enter here and through the galleries here, here, and here, and there's a staircase at one end and at the other end, and the doorways that we made between the galleries. And then plan at the upper level, showing three gallery spaces. And you can see the brick pier structure of the wall, which became a very useful place to locate the vertical duct work and the bridge here. And the galleries are all different sizes and proportions and heights, but actually, because the number of doorways is relatively small and the lengths of the walls between the doorways is very wide, they make very good gallery spaces. In the elevation, we tried hard to match the brick of the new buildings with the old building. It was an impossible task because the existing building was built out of several different colours of brickwork, but we made a close match with a company from Gloucestershire called Northcott. It's a kind of cheap, flattened brick with a smooth surface rather than a coarse London stock finish. Northcott actually made a special brick for us. You can buy it now. This one's called Newport Street Light. And the base is the same brick with a black wash with an extra firing, which is called Newport Street Dark. The gallery spaces on the ground floor are 7 meters high, with natural light coming in through existing clerestory windows. And we're looking here to the first show, which was Damien Hirst's collection of John Hoyland paintings. And upstairs, we're in one of the existing former scenery painting studios with the existing timber roof structure. And we're looking at a current Jeff Koons exhibition. I think what's special about, for people who really like art, to go to this gallery, which is open to the public for free, is that because it's a private gallery, he can install the work how he wants. So you're looking here at pieces, very few pieces in a gallery. They all have lots of space around them, which you can't do in a in a public museum. You can have much higher levels of light if you own the art. And you don't have to have interpretation or labels. So it's a very, I think, different experience of looking at contemporary art, which is what he wanted. The staircases in the building are very important. I think, to me, they make the difference between it feeling like a public building and an industrial conversion of an industrial building. I showed you pictures of the brick structures of the existing historic buildings, which, of course, you have to cover up because if you're making flexible spaces for exhibitions, you need white walls. So in the staircases, we made brick structures. It's a white engineering brick, and the handrail is a kind of precast pieces which bear the vertical load of the wall. And then the staircases are made out of engineered timber by a special company in Darmstadt called Deutsche Werkstätten. I think the staircases are obviously special. I think when you have to walk up 8 meters, when you want to bring the public up 8 meters, and if you want to make the upper floor as important as the ground floor, then the way up has to be well done. So they're double spirals. And they're very wide. The galleries don't have windows. I think for galleries of that type, it wouldn't be appropriate to have windows, really. I think the sort of shows he wants to have, you want to have the galleries well lit by daylight, but without the distraction of looking out. So the staircases are, in a way, a counterpoint to that. They don't have windows either, but they have roof lights and a very generous well, so that they feel like a kind of special space between galleries. And the staircase is also important at the front to mediate between the ground floor and the first floor galleries to the rather full-on restaurant space, which was designed by the artist and his studio with our assistants. For example, the floor here, which is quite difficult to do, is a white terrazzo with inset pills that are made with water jet cut marble, and the stained glass windows are by Lalique. And then when you're looking at the building, as many people can do from the train, the commuters going into Waterloo, there's a very large LED screen on the facade in the same place where the theatre poster used to be sited. And the current show that's on in the building of Jeff Koons is on until the 16th of October. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Chris Loyne, Director of Loyne & Co. Architects. The making of the outhouse was a very special experience. We had a wonderful client, an amazing site, and the gizmo's not working. Yep, and an amazing site. The design team worked tremendously well together, and the contractor was excellent. It's rare to have all of those ingredients in one project. So here are our clients, Michael and Jean. Flip back a bit, sorry. Here are our clients, Michael and Jean, two artists who have lived and worked in the Forest of Dean for many years. The site is 4 acres of gently sloping south-facing land. It comprises an upper meadow, a central level plateau, and a lower meadow. This is a lane and offers a spur of Offa's Dyke runs there. This is the driveway which bisects the site and is part of that plateau, and it's been retained and forms the east-west axis line for the organisation and the plan of the outhouse. Although the existing buildings had no real architectural merit, we felt they should be treated as part of the history of the site and could have a role to play in the proposed new development. If you peep over the hedge, you get an idea of the beautiful landscape that unfolds southward along the Wye Valley towards the River Severn. The client's brief was for a low-impact, single-level live-work house. The question was, how do you site and organise and anchor with meaning what was clearly going to be a much larger building? It's 500 square metres than the buildings that were on the site at present. The concept we arrived at was to use the existing structures to allow them, or the memory of them, to discipline the layout of the new house. We felt this gave relevance to the new house by responding to and respecting its history, integrating the old with the new, the past with the present. The idea was to remove the roofs of the houses and the two of the house and the two outbuildings, and to leave them as open containers. New accommodation was then to be arranged around these retained open shells and the upper meadow extended over, but leaving the inside of the old buildings as external courtyards within the new building envelope, hence the name we gave to the project, the Inside Outside House. It was later shortened in the interests of brevity. This is a very early sketch, one of my first doodles, the driveway approach. Michael and Jean's brief was quite clear in so much as they did not want a showy house, nothing ostentatious or pretentious. They wanted it to be quiet, to sit in the landscape, not on the landscape, to be comfortable in its setting. And here are some of the drawings as the scheme evolved. My sketches from the day book during the meetings, exploring different ideas for the courtyards, 4 courtyards, earth, air, fire, and water. And then testing different sizes of the buildings, different configurations and layouts, and moving towards the planning drawings. These are the elevations with the what I call the threshold plans, the junction between the inside and the outside, and the south elevation. This is the final version of the roof plan, and you can see the 4 courtyards, earth, air, fire, water. Underneath the roof, we, of course, have the floor plan. It's a single-level dwelling. The 4 courtyards shown there. This is the street, the gallery, that bisects the whole of the building with the work portion embedded into the hill on the north side, the living accommodation, the bedrooms on the left, and the sitting, dining, and kitchen on the right, on the eastern end of the building. And then the sort of ancillary accommodation hooked off the top of the spine. And this is it built. I think you can see it is a very quiet building. The driveway, we closed this off for the duration of the works in order to protect it. If you'd run concrete lorries up and down there, it would not be the same. Bump, this is jumping. That's the roof from the upper meadow just after completion. And as the scars of construction started to be healed, the grass took over. And look at that, beautiful flower meadow. This was taken just earlier this summer. The new house is truly embedded, part of the site, inseparable from the meadow from which it is made. Then you can read the voids. Then you can read the voids. You can look down into the earth courtyard, or in, on the left there, the fire courtyard. That's the old house. And on the right, look up from the water courtyard. That is the old garage. These courtyards are not only beautiful and unexpected spaces to find within a house, they're also functional, bringing light and air deep into the plan of the building. Light from the sky is wonderful, but to have external space within adds another dimension to the experience. There are outside rooms inside the house. And then out of the west end of the gallery street, and we have the pond, wrapped in salvaged stone from the site. The wall separates outhouse from a spur of Offa's Dyke. As one of the RIBA judges said, the front door of the gallery is at one end and Wales is at the other. I rather like that. Let's have a wander around the south side of the building. That's the southwest corner, the bedroom wing, and the earth courtyard that separates the bedroom from the living accommodation. The central sitting room, and to the right, the kitchen, and then the walkway, which runs the whole length of the building, a full 55 metres. And to prevent you slipping on the surface, we have lovingly pressed in ferns and foliage from the site. It's true collaboration between architect and artist. At the end of the walkway, at the far east, by the kitchen, is the original orchard, which we retained. You can lean off the walkway, pluck an apple, or you can pick herbs from the herb baskets that we've positioned alongside. And late in the contract, Michael and Jean decided that they wanted to have a separate garden store. So we left the site cabin in situ. We clad it with scorched timber used elsewhere in the building, put a bit of sedum on it, a splash of red to match the rosy red apples, and I think it sits comfortably within this part of the site, and it's part of the story of the making of this building. It's part of the history now. We also made a sheep shelter for Jean's flock of soy sheep. Now to go inside the main entrance, looking back from the front door along the driveway. Spin around. And this is the gallery, a continuation of that access set up by the original driveway. And here's Jean hanging paintings, preparing for a show. Until this moment, visitors to Outhouse have no real idea of the truly spectacular views that the house commands, as the approach has been largely sheltered by the now high hedging. At this point, a glimpse is given, a taster of what is to come from this framed view. As you proceed down the gallery street, you reach a central living area, the heart of the house, looking southward through the earth courtyard and sitting area with the panoramic forest views stretched out before you. It is interesting, this differentiation between house and home. Michael and Jean have a lifetime of quality belongings that they have brought with them. These make this house their home, and it works, the old coexisting comfortably with the new, just like the architectural concept. This is the kitchen, with the living space beyond. And at the western end of the house, you have the bedroom accommodation, Jean's corner bath with a corner window and a pretty good view, and Michael's bedroom, the bed he carved himself, looking into the earth courtyard. From the sitting area, if you cross across the gallery street, there are two studios hunkered into the hill, but not dark spaces. Both studios have substantial roof glazing and their own outside space. This is Michael's studio with his sculpture courtyard beyond, cored out of the hill, and Jean's studio leading directly onto the pond court. This is an earth shelter house, and as such, concrete was the only sensible choice of material for the superstructure. In addition, Michael and Jean said on numerous occasions how, as a backdrop, the concrete complements all different artworks. We devised them a hanging system for their work to allow them flexibility to regularly change their art. And the imprints of the plants achieve a poetic connection between the building and the surrounding natural beauty, as well, of course, as we use the actual soil and the meadow planting, both of which were set aside at the start of the work and then relaid and sown to create the seamless junction between field and roof. Concrete is full of life. It's rich in pattern, shadow and shade. It's simply beautiful. It is far more There's far more warmth than there is in painted plaster. The timber cladding we used has been scorched rather than painted, and it gives a depth of color, tone and natural finish. At the end of the day, we architects can draw and specify all we like, but if the people actually making the building, the craftspeople, do not fully engage and love what they are doing, then the end product will be less than imagined. I started this talk making reference to the fantastic teamwork of the Outhouse project. The main contractor was Chris Milliner. He was simply extraordinary and entered into the whole job with an attitude of total commitment and cooperation. This project was built on a design-build form of contract, a whole bucket load of trust and friendship. Michael and Jean and others have said, you can feel this within the house. So finally, photographs, even film, are so inadequate to convey the atmosphere, the real feeling of the house. Architecture has to be visited to truly understand what makes a place special. Yep, this is a house in the country, but I believe deeply that the ingredients that make this a special place are entirely transferable to housing generally in our towns and cities. We need better quality housing in this country of ours than that which is all too often delivered by the builders of dumb anywhere boxes. Surely we still deserve a little bit of commodity firmness and, so importantly, delight. Good night. Thank you very much.
Wow, how'd you follow that? With a bit more housing. All right. I'm Philip Marsh from DRMM Architects. So ours is a slightly larger scale project. So our approach to Trafalgar Place, which is in the Elephant and Castle, as with all our built projects, is a direct response to the brief, the site constraints, and the site opportunities. For all our residential projects, be it high-end affordable or for affordable, for either affordable or high-end residential, we try to create a high-quality built environment that offers variety, delight, whilst fostering a sense of neighbourliness. We create homes with identities, allowing residents to identify their homes in the overall composition and try to imbue a sense of pride and a feeling of ownership in their built environment. A little bit of history. The Haygate, as I'm sure you're familiar with, was designed by Tim Tinker. I worked for Southwark Council for 7 years, neo-brutalist aesthetic, and it was completed in 1974. Construction costs were high at the time, so he employed a system-built, unitised process of factory-made concrete panels that required less labour for fabrication on site. He organised the Haygate with tall linear blocks and smaller perpendicular blocks of maisonettes, and that comprised a grid which worked within the greater master plan. Elevated walkways meant the residents didn't have to walk on the pavements. However, by the 1990s, the Haygate was synonymous with crime and inner-city decay, a sentiment not shared by many of the residents of the Haygate. By 2011, the Haygate had been demolished. So this is the site of Trafalgar Place. So Tim has imposed his standard grid from the wider master plan onto this site, but made no concession to the triangular nature of this peculiar corner of the Haygate. This is our third project that we've worked on in the Elephant and Castle, having completed Wandsley Street and Harper Square. So we've got to know some of the concerns of the local residents and their sentiments about change and about what's important to them in the new built environment. They want a sense of community. They want to have routes and connections. There's a concern that new housing standards are not going to be as great as the Parker Morris standards, but in fact the London Housing Design standards are in excess of the Parker Morris standards for this type of accommodation with deck access. And there was a very loud demand from everyone in the community that we had to retain the urban forest, which is all those fantastic London plane trees that define the Haygate. So the site strategy was developed in parallel to MAKE, who are working on the wider master plan for the Elephant and Castle at Elephant Park. So we were busy doing our own thing in this little triangular site off to one corner. So we developed the approach to the site in close collaboration with Lendlease, who is the client, and Southwark Planning, and the numerous iterations of the site and how we should organise the buildings. Unlike Tim's approach to the site, we have followed the curves and the lines of Rodney Road, and we have a series of very faceted buildings that change and respond to the context around the site. Overlaid onto that are four clusters of London plane trees, which we've retained and moved the buildings away, so they create natural breaks between the buildings. There was an opportunity to have height towards the north that anticipated the wider master plan, and there was a need to have a southern gateway that announced the site coming up from the Aylesbury. And the main strategic move was to introduce an east-west route across the site, which had been forgotten about in the previous iteration of the design. So you can see this is a section north-south through the site. So we have the woodland walk along Victory Place. We have woodland plant in an informal play space. We have the main east-west link route, which is Paragon Walk, which is predominantly hard landscaping. We have a raised courtyard of productive planting and a southern gateway. So 46% of the site is publicly accessible. And the design through this iterative process looked at every element of the design in detail and the composition and the relationship with the existing primary school, the views through from Henshaw Street about how we continue that east-west route, the Rose and Crown pub, and about looking at the height and the massing of the raised courtyard, and levels had been dropped and reduced further from this sketch. So it's a very worked master plan. It's not a simple composition that we just imposed onto the site. We worked very closely with Grant Associates, who did all the landscaping. And there's four main character areas of which they then developed subgroups. So there's formalising of the main group of London players to the north with this woodland walk. There's the route through, and we have a heart space where the residents and the public can dwell and enjoy the new space that's been created, the raised courtyard and the gateway site to the south. The section shows the approach to the subsystem, so on the top of all the roofs, water is collected, and then the courtyard is a blue roof, so water is attenuated, and we have a swale, so water is slowly dissipated into the ground. Biodiversity roofs and PVs, which are all quite standard in terms of current housing standards. But the beauty of having this quite complex set of geometric forms and the stepping meant that we have a really interesting spatial spaces between the buildings, creating complexity and great opportunities for the landscape. At the heart space, we have the rain garden, which is a visual representation of the subsystem. So even when it's not torrential downpour, you can still understand that there's a movement of water that happens on the site. This is the raised courtyard, where residents are encouraged to grow and to plant and to produce food. So they're just starting to form a collective that organizes the productive beds. And then this is the southern gateway facing towards the Aylesbury, towards the south of the site. So the scheme's very much a contextual response, both in terms of the massing, but also in terms of the materiality. So looking around at the site, we've got these fantastic 19th century brick buildings and this very beautiful one, which is Peabody building, which has lovely brown brick at the base, red in the body, yellow terracotta or faience, and blue slate roof. So We've not produced a brick building before, but it just seemed really appropriate that this site demanded that we respond contextually. So we've gone ahead and done our first brick building. But rather than just use one brick, we thought we'd use all the bricks. And that works really nicely with the Peabody building opposite. So we've not set out each brick individually, although we could have if need be. But they've been batched so that the whole facade builds up as it goes to this sort of striation of different colours. So we did some mock-ups. We learnt about bricks. So the bricks on the right are by Ibstock, which I'm sure you would have heard of. Ibstock have been busy buying up all different brick manufacturers up and down the country. That's where you get this sort of fragmented colour band. Whereas on the left, this is the one that everyone was thrilled and delighted with. This is Freshfield Lane. So all of these bricks come from the same clay and in the same firing. So they all come out at the same time, which is why they've got that beautiful palette that runs through. It's only the engineering ones at the top which aren't from Freshfield Lane. So they're traditional, fired in traditional brick clamps, and so out of this you get everything from the London stocks to the black bricks that have been through the brick clamp a few times. And this is the realisation of that whole colour banding on Rodney Road. So this is a sort of pixelated interpretation of the Peabody building mirrored onto Rodney Road. And then this full colour banding then turns into a red street that runs east-west across the site. And then the courtyards we've made quite quiet, so they're just in a London stock. We didn't have any precedent for how to articulate brick buildings. We hadn't developed a sensibility about it, so we've just been quite playful and developed detailing linear banding and brick shutters around windows, and used just a simple timber joint where the yellow facade joins into the red one. So it's quite playful in its approach. But it seems to have worked. And there's some lovely moments where the different colours come together, and with the engineering bricks at the top mixed in with the triple burnt ones, you get this lovely play of light of the glossy and the reflection and the matte bricks. It's a very high quality building, and I think a lot of Haygate residents had reservations about the quality of what was going to be built and what was going to replace the estate. What Lenleys have built is in a testament to that statement they made about quality. All the windows are timber composites. We have high levels of thermal performance of the facades. And there's interesting views where it's quite contextualised with the primary school and existing smaller buildings around the site. We're very keen to promote or to look at new forms of construction. So Lenleys used this project as a sort of test bed for the wider master plan. So two of the blocks were built in cross-laminated timber, and we've got quite big spans here of 7 metres. So there's real program benefits in terms of cross-laminated timber, but Lenleys wanted to understand the benefits and the savings of second fix. So they've adopted this for later phases, predominantly for the smaller low-rise and townhouses. So all the facades are very activated. We have front doors onto Rodney Road. So these are the sort of L-shaped townhouses that step up. So although they've got front doors here, they've also got big sliding doors that open out onto the courtyard, and there's residential entrances in the folds and the setbacks along the facades. So every facade is different, and there's a lot of variety. So this is a nice story as well. This is Jean and Reg, who have lived in and around the Trafalgar Place for their entire lives. Jean went to the primary school next door and then grew up in one of the streets, Chatham Street, and so she's lived in the area for 70 years as her husband, and it's fantastic that they're able to to benefit from the transformation that's happened here at Trafalgar Place. So this isn't a show apartment, this is their apartment. So this is for L&Q, and they were delighted obviously with the quality of the accommodation. So this is an affordable rent. So very proud of what's been delivered, and we see our scheme as reconnecting with the existing fabric and the context. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jeff Turner of Wilkinson Air Architects. So it seems very appropriate today to talk to you about a building which is primarily about books, seeing that it's National Reader Book Day. So I'm hoping you've all been reading books today. The Bodleian Library is one of the great research libraries in the world. It was founded in 1602 by Sir Thomas Bodley and have been collecting books for obviously over 400 years. And then is also one of the five Library of Copyrights in the UK. It was entitled to receive any book that's published within Great Britain. Obviously this presents at intermittent periods spatial challenges with continual growth. The other thing, the Bodleian Library is actually 43 libraries within Oxford, but the heart of the library is effectively these buildings on the right-hand side, which are highlighted there. The sequence of spaces from the High Street through to Broad Street is amazing. It's a who's who of architecture there. You have Gibbs's Radcliffe Camera through to the old Bodleian, where the interiors, the Duke Humphreys Library and the Divinity School are amazing. You have the Clarendon Building, which is owned by the Bodleian, and then adjacent to it, not part of the Bodleian, you have one of Wren's first commissions, major commissions for the Sheldonian Theatre. And then you have Scott's new Bodleian Library. Very big building. So Scott is more known, really, he's known for his power stations, he's known for, Battersea and Bankside, now Tate Modern, and obviously his cathedrals, large buildings. But obviously, he also did, the red telephone box that people less know about. So the Bodleian Library was as a result of, exponential growth of the collections. And so what Scott actually built was 11 stories, 11-story, very dense, tight steel structure with very thin floor-to-floor heights, 7'6", 8'6", 8 foot all the way up. So literally, just above your head inside. Very clever in terms of maximizing the quantum of books on a central city site, but absolutely not very clever in terms of fire protection. And the number one, Bible in terms of archival standard is 4-hour fire protection. And obviously, there's been some very, horrendous examples of that only a couple of years ago at the Glasgow School of Art. And so this, and there was an assessment taken at the time that if there had been a fire, there was a 1 in 3 chance of a total building collapse. There were also problems with the temperature and humidity and the cramped conditions within the space. But from the streetscape, it was clever. I mean, it looks like a two-story building with a three-story setback. But obviously, it lacked, lacks identity, as you can see from this building, this picture on the right-hand side. Unless you were a reader, you wouldn't know it was part of the collection. The architectural historian Howard Colvin described it as a dinner jacket made of Harris tweed. But we learned to appreciate the building for what it was. Scott stood on this stage as president of the RIBA in 1933 and sort of urged his colleagues to adopt a middle line to combine tradition and modernity. The building is very much evident in that he uses, traditional craftsmanship and techniques, but then mixes it with, modern building technologies. This is the very first use of major scale aluminium in the UK. And it became a listed building in 2003. So in 2006, there was an architectural competition created by the summer 2006 by the University Estates and the Bodleian Libraries, led by then the deputy librarian, Richard Ovenden, who's now Bodley's librarian. So they turned what was effectively a technical problem into an opportunity. So the three criteria of the brief was 1, safeguarding the collections, 2, improving research facilities, and 3, increasing public engagement and access. So it's quite rare that two projects from the same town are on the shortlist. We've already seen earlier on today a little bit about Oxford and the Quads. But we sort of analysed the area, and there's an amazing sort of composition of streets and spaces, buildings, entrances, vistas, not quite aligning. But in essence, the Bodleian, in terms of form, is just like any other Oxford quad, but this quad is full of books as opposed to a lawn. I already mentioned the sort of building issues. So building issues of identity, confusing entrance, and sort of sterilizing the end of Broad Street. So how are we to sort of open that up to achieve the brief and the architectural issues? Getting back to what was here before, very cramped conditions inside the stack, a steel frame which created a fire path right through the building, and really woefully inadequate services. So the building had a very strong diagram, a central book stack, which rose the 11 stories, and you can see the ziggurat type form that I was meaning. So you have to be quite a long back, way back, before you can appreciate the book stack tower at the top, and then a corridor circulation, and then accommodation around the outside. So the principal moves we made were to open up, everything pink and red is what was demolished in effect. So we opened the windows and spandrel panels to create public access through from the south side of the building. Previously, everyone had entered through here. And then we've demolished the 11 stories of stack, 80 tons of asbestos, 1,000 tons of steel. And then we created two new cores, a people moving core and a book moving core, which rised up through those previous 11 stories, three of which below ground and now eight above ground. And then they support what we referred to this floating stack, which is in effect a large concrete Vimrindil structure, and to create an open plan floor place or an open quad in the center of Oxford for the public to access. So conceptually and physically, it's about connecting this 1930s building with the grade one star 17th century and 18th century buildings across the road. And I think these two drawings, the plan and the section, illustrate that well. I mean, I mentioned creating this connection from Broad Street here, as opposed to the previous entrance there. And then the other thing to remember is that this has become a purely special collections library. So they're rarest, they're most fragile, they're most valuable. So, they're copies of the Gutenberg Bible, they're copies of the Magna Carta and the like, will never set foot outside of this building. For 70 years, they used to be transported either via conveyor, which from this building, under that tunnel, and then up into the reading rooms of the old Bodleian. There is, which obviously was another significant fire and flood risk. That tunnel has now been got floodproof doors and fire-rated doors. But the other strange, very strange thing about the building, the two images at the top are during construction, you see the steel frame, was at this east end, there was this really odd plinth at about a metre tall, which really, only ever got used by skateboarders and really sterilised the end of Broad Street when it's opposite a Wren and a Hawksmoor building. It was an odd move. We earlier found some drawings from Scott, which actually he originally intended it to be a garden, but I think it must have got value engineered out. So we effectively opened up the facade here by the landscaping, by creating this colonnade. You bring people into the building, it signifies entrance. It seemed to us the reorientation of the building entrance onto the south side seemed to be the natural thing to do for the building. So we achieved that, this is a study model on the left-hand side. We achieved that by turning what was a series of pilasters into columns to create this colonnade. And you can see it lightens up the facade and signifies entrance. I mentioned earlier on about identity and how the building didn't have an identity. We wanted to make this building, as soon as you entered the building, you knew you were in a library. And so we playing on the quad theme, we created an elevated cloister of books at upper level so that as a member of the public, you can come in and you can see readers accessing open access collections from the reading rooms above. It's also, a generous internal public space. There isn't a publicly accessible space, of this sort of size and scale in Oxford. And so it's an inviting quad and it's, placemaking quad for Oxford. The floating stack is, we inclined the walls 2 degrees, so to channel the light down into the walls, rather like Soane used to do in buildings. And we have these slot roof lights, which we've taken the theme again, creates a mellow diffused light down into the space. I found this interesting quote from Scott whilst he was designing the libraries in the 1930s. He once speculated that in the future, libraries as we know them will have ceased to exist, and a central television station will wireless visions of books to readers' homes, and they will turn the pages by pressing a button. I thought this was a rather good premonition of the internet from 70 or 80 years ago. But what, and yes, the Bodleian has extensive digitization programs of these wonderful collections they have, but what we've found is the digital access to these collections has actually increased the public's and the scholars' appetite and desire for the primacy of the original artifact. We created exhibition galleries, and so we spent a lot of time with the conservation and the exhibition team to best display those books. We've been to museums and we've seen books on display, but we really wanted to lift the display of the books. So we designed with them, with the conservation team, how the stalks and the cradles work so we could display the books like floating butterflies. But getting back, as I mentioned, the safeguarding of the collections is the foundation of this project. The built heritage of this building is significant in its greater listed, but the heritage within is phenomenal. The BS 5454, I've unfortunately become an expert in, is the Bible of archival standards, which deals with fire protection, security, temperature and humidity. So now in this building there are 43 kilometres of archival storage in the basement there. And these days, to increase the protection even more, they're all in their own individual boxes, tailor-made to the size. We also did lots of consultations with the curatorial and the conservation teams to make sure that the sort of transformative ways of working, previously they've been dotted around different buildings, different spaces, and they're all working together now. And then, although the archival books are now in the basement book stack in ideal conditions, those same books are much more accessible to readers now. The 1940s catalogue room has been refurbished to something much more better access for the readers, and the like. And then we also, really went into a lot of detail on how a reader uses the space. We really did agonise over the details and the materials, just not just for the architectural finishes, but the desks, the shelving, the counters, so that the readers touch and feel on a regular basis. And then when you get to the very top, the final new reading room is the David reading room, which works with the slot windows, the proportions of the room, materials and the light to create a new space, which has the sort of scholarly gravitas you would associate with a reading room of this type of library. Finally, just like to touch on, the client, i.e. the University Estates, the Bodleian Libraries, and their patrons, the Weston family and the Blackwells, were fantastic in championing the architecture and the public access from the start. With their support and our transformation remodeling of the building, Oxford now has a wonderful contribution to the city and the university. The responsibility of such a culturally and architecturally sensitive project was not lost on us, and one which we loved working on and thrilled to make the shortlist. And I'll leave you with the Dreaming Spires.
I'm just going to invite all the... Is that very loud? It sounds loud to me. I'm going to invite all the speakers to come up, and I'd like to engage... Well, I hope you'd like to engage with them in a discussion. First of all, I'd like to thank them for their creativity, a commitment to craft and collaboration, and also, I didn't have to hold my phone up too much to warn them they were running out of time, so the concision was pretty good. I think we've got about 10 minutes. There are two people wandering around with mics, so we'll come to questions in a minute. So while you formulate your questions, which I'd like to be questions rather than statements of your view of the world today, but before that, I'd like to invite Christine Murray, the editor-in-chief of the Architects Journal and Architects Review, just to kind of respond to what she's seen today. Christine.
So big task, 60 minutes in 3 minutes. But, first of all, it's worth saying half of the projects on the shortlist are higher education buildings. And I think that's a reflection of the RIBA Awards in general. It was 26%, so nearly a third of all RIBA awards this year went to higher education buildings. So I think that's a reflection of the kind of work, the high quality work that's been being done over the last few years since the introduction of tuition fees. And these have become very important clients, and they've also become, clients that are understand the usefulness of a building, not only in attracting students, but also in attracting funding. So that's kind of a key role, and that subtext is there. And in these buildings, you see the changing approach to teaching in these schools. I mean, these kind of the activation of the circulation space, the importance of socialization, the idea that you need to be bumping into each other to learn and to have private, but also a lot of sharing. So I think that comes through there. And that emphasis on the social, that's part of this kind of post-digital world that we live in, where what are these live spaces for? What do we need to do when we actually bother to come together in a real place? I think, looking at other links across the projects, I mean, half of them are struggling with this idea of connecting to nature, but the challenge of the climate. So, you know, the courtyard, the view in the garden, the revised viewing. I mean, that's not a new architectural challenge, but it's something that that kind of comes through. There's also an emphasis on stitching together old and new, seeking that balance, architecture as an evolving conversation. How do we bring that old and new together? I think the Stirling Prize, we talk about it, you know, its role in celebrating great architecture and great British architecture. I think also we talk about its importance in communicating to the public what architects do. And I think in some ways that message is difficult this year because we don't have a public building or a school or a hospital or a Maggie Center, something that's directly connects with everyone. So I think if I had to lead that conversation and say, you know, what is this year's story to the public, I'd probably maybe talk about this idea about architecture bringing people together. So how do we get people to interact and to have to come out and to have a kind of formative experience in a space that can potentially change you or give you a new idea or help you to meet someone or help you to learn. And I think that's probably what I took away.
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much, Christine. Questions? I'm sure there's an enthusiastic... Okay, right. Right, the very back, there's a mic coming your way. When you get it, don't wave it around. Treat it like a kind of a whippy ice cream. Put it very close to your mouth.
Thanks for the great...
Sure, stand up so we can see you. So
there's obviously a series of common themes through the projects we've seen, but I'm going to ask a deceptively and topically explosive question, potentially. But what are the contemporary... What is the unique quality of contemporary British architecture in the context of what we've seen this evening?
Unique quality. Okay, I'm going to whiz this one around the panel and give them each about 15 seconds. I won't time you. Unique quality of contemporary British architecture, as in British done in Britain, because it's done by international people as well. Interesting. Okay, Chris.
What an awful question. The unique...
You're almost out of time.
I would say context. We're seeing now, particularly in my field of housing, instead of the typical face for an elevation of a house, you now respond to, where's the sun coming up? It's over there, so you move your eye to over there, and you get more of a Picasso than a Leonardo. So the setting sun's over there, and you twist things. There's still balance, there's still beauty. That's, to me, what we're missing, particularly in the housing market. It's all still rooted in this idea of a symmetrical front door, a little child's drawing. And I think we've got to shift away from that very, very quickly.
Peter, you touched on this a little bit about the 1980s, when you and Adam were looking around and looking at what you found versus what was being done. Is there, I mean, you covered it in some sense, but is there any particular thing you feel? And also, you're now working very much internationally as well, as this is almost... something of a return to London, although you're here, you're working in Switzerland. How do you see that? You know, is there anything unique? Is there anything?
British architecture. Yeah. I think that's a difficult question. And I don't think we would agree either. I don't think everyone's going to say the same thing. To me, I think British architects bring into a European conversation perhaps more interest in context and more generally perhaps more interest in history and how, whether you're designing housing or a museum or a library.
Well, that's good.
How precedence and context can inform how you make cities.
You said you're doing Herzog de Meuron's projects here, but obviously you're an international practice working all over the world. Is there anything unique at all, or are we just another context, very variable? Oxford is very different from the Laban Centre in Deptford. Is there anything unique to our context?
I don't think that's a speciality of the British contemporary architecture. I think in general, education also for architecture became a little bit more sophisticated maybe in the last years and decades, and I think the architects are basically just a little bit more caring about what's happening around them. And like everything in the society, in the current society, you should care a little bit more. And I think that's, I mean, it was like that in the 70s, I would say. And it's coming back. It's like a little bit of a trend, I would say. So people look a little bit more carefully, and and the results are accordingly.
Philip, you talked about the particular context of the Haygate estate, a very different time, where one could say the difference between then and now is there was much more confidence, not necessarily correctly placed, in a kind of clear and restart, build a brave new world. Every project today has been pitched into its place in time and physically. You know, is that restrictive to what you were doing? Is that the kind of constraint that generates the creativity?
Yeah, totally. I think, I don't know if our architecture is particularly unique. It's unique to us as a practice because it's such a contextualized response. But you're very mindful of what's gone before in the Haygate and the successes and or failings of it. It's only 37 years old when it was demolished, and you spend any time with the residents or the people who have experienced it, and you understand the big impact it had on their lives. And I suppose from the first project we did in the Elephant and Castle, the kind of brief was about, to develop architecture, which is everything that the Haygate wasn't. So we're kind of on that journey about trying to create kind of the opposite. And I suppose on the site that we have in Rodney Road, in that corner of the site, we're able to contextualize. So we're able to try and be the sort of antithesis of the system-built approach.
I mean, Jeff, in many ways, yours is the most constrained of the projects, constrained by the history of Oxford, as is... as was Askans, or enlivened. But at the same time, a while ago, one might have thought, why are we bothering with this Grade 2 listed building that fails on numerous technical levels, and maybe a lot of urban levels, and maybe on some architectural levels? Do you, is that constraint of this engagement with the complexity of program that exists for all projects, but then actually this found piece, is that enriching to you, or... You're doing something, you're investigating something similar but different at Battersea, aren't you?
Yeah, I mean, the Western Library, the more, a lot of people, no one loved that building in Oxford, and the more we got to understand the building, get under the skin of the building, the more we appreciated, there were some great details there, there's some clever things he did, there were some clever things on massing, in terms of massing, opening up views that had never been there before, from medieval days and the like, and connecting some of the streets from the east-west road. So we got a much better understanding of what Scott was trying to achieve. And so therefore, it was very important to us to take the best of those bits. And yes, there was the technical problems, but take the best of those good bits and work with it to create a sort of new sort of public space for...
Lyle and Brendan, Glasgow, there didn't seem to be much... There's much urban context, but no site, in sense of what was there. It was a found situation into which you inserted a statement. Was there much history to build upon?
It was the site of the pre-existing Maritime College. So the facilities you'd have seen in the river were pre-existing. So those orange boats, maritime students actually go only at high tide, go at high tide, get into those boats and get dropped into the river so they can practice that regime. So the context that we sought for the project was, it had its function there, but beyond that, before the clearances of the Gorbals, was part of that Glasgow grid that crossed from the north into the south of the city. And so we were trying to reintroduce that in a small part. If I can go back to the question, I like the question. it evokes Britishness. Oh, scary. what I liked about it was the idea that, that there may be some common threads or themes. I think that there was the attitude to place, but actually I think at the heart of all of the projects tonight was an idea about people. And the people that use our buildings are usually at the heart of contemporary architecture's thinking. So I think all of the projects, in their own different ways, really hard about their programme and the people that would use them. So that the theme, because it was a diverse set of people, gives a diverse set of projects.
Christine.
Yeah, briefly, the Italian-Canadian on the unique British scene. There's a fetishization of brick, clearly. That's also shared by planners quite a lot, so I think that comes through. And then this mix of, there's a lot of nostalgia. I kind of sense this nostalgia. There's a great love for what was there. And I think this dance between nostalgia and some idea of progress.
Okay.
But I don't agree.
Okay, you're good.
It's about nostalgia. I mean, I think if you build in London, then it's fairly obvious that you build in brick. I think if you build in another city, if you build in Zurich, you might build in precast concrete. I think to me that's not about nostalgia, it's just about good sense, actually. You're responding to a specific situation.
Good. I like it. tell us who you are, just stand up so you can project.
Tim Sanderson from Place Builder Architects. Can you share with us a little headache that tripped you up along the way, but you're quite chuffed with, that you resolved? Are you brave enough to share a little horror story that you overcame?
I can imagine they could all share you numerous horror stories. Anyone, I don't think we'll go around the table. Anyone got something in particular? Brendan.
Yeah, I think when you speak to contractors, they say it's hard enough working with one architect, but they actually work with two. It was a problem but actually we didn't have much of a problem at all. We had a very similar ethos.
You say that.
Yeah. Till tonight.
Two Glaswegian architects, okay. Chris?
One of the interesting things with the outhouse was the engineer, following the client's brief, was very keen to minimise the amount of concrete used. And so along the front facade, where there were particular beams and particular ground conditions, he devised an individual scheme for each one of those beams. And it drove the contractor nuts. Because although it was saving concrete, of course, there's time, there's effort, there's energy, there's thought, there's risk. And it was the debate between those to get it solved was really fascinating. And that's when design build, which I said is what the project was, which I think is incredible, it was based on this trust and collaboration, and between all of the design team, then we sorted it out and we got it done in a balance between, but the right solution was...
I mean, 20 years ago, design and build was a sort of anathema. It is now part of daily life. All the architects, in a sense, there was a tale, whether it was in that room upstairs or on the floor here tonight, the lectern, about sort of commitment. Buildings and... We talk about the practice or the individuals named. Buildings are incredibly complex collaborations between thinkers, makers, craftspeople, the interface between contractors as logistical managers. But to get the level of quality everyone achieved is all about, there must be some magic that comes out. So whilst, I'm sure there was a lot of problems, there's something about teams coming together to do something and people kind of throwing away contracts and getting on with it. I think we've got 5 minutes.
I'd like to join in one little bit. Our project was effectively a Scottish PFI project, And at the point of us making the planning application, there was a whole shadow team that had a full planning application ready, and they just threw theirs in the bin. So I would say that there's something wrong with the process, which is to drive the cheapest pound per square meter for the commissioning client means that we as an industry have to waste our efforts. So I think there's definitely something to attend to there.
There's many things wrong.
I'm happy to share a moment which kept me at night.
Enthusiasm for talking about pain is impressive.
You know, working with an existing building, you know, there's obvious unknowns that you're going to find. And the biggest unknown that we found that caused us the biggest headache and sleepless nights was, for a short period, was, you know, those 11 stories of book stack. When we'd removed them, and then we started to break up the screed at the bottom to put a new tanking layer in, none of those steels, the original steels, were bolted to the original slab. So we had a big, effectively open space donut in the middle of the building, which subject to wind loads, where it's never been subject to wind loads before, and we had to frantically bolt those steels down around the outside.
It's good to know the engineers have got over-design in for over 70 years. Quick one.
One very quick one. I'm confessing twice now. This is probably not acceptable, but here we go. The idea had been originally to keep the original stone walls intact, but this is how berserk the system and unjoined up it can be. If we had done that, there was a high risk that that house would have been considered as an extension to the existing buildings and would have come under VAT. So we took them down and replaced them with ghosts in black concrete to symbolize death.
Do we have one more question? I mean, there is a bar that will open. You're a full audience, and they've done a lot of work. Do we have one more question to... Here we do have one more question. Here's the speaker.
I'm Tina James. With all ingredients which architecture is created, there is one very major constraint, and I wonder how nobody mentioned ever the budget. And the budget is something which... stays, either gives inspiration and ingenuity or constrains down what ones want to do. How did you cope with it?
I always think that with architects, the budget is the element that is signed off at the end of the project, which means all projects are on time and on budget. But you may have a different view. Go on quickly. Just a private house, was there money swashing around? Is the budget always a problem?
There wasn't money sloshing around. Every project has a budget and you build to it. What it was a sensible amount of money for that project for the square footage that we got. I'm not going to tell you what it is because I'm not allowed to.
Peter, you were dealing in the world of art where Damien, you know, gets involved in extraordinary purchases and sales of art, and architecture is just a tiny fragment of the value of his estate. How constrained?
I think that's true. I think actually the art is worth more than his estate, and certainly
that's what I mean.
Art in the building was worth a lot more than the building.
Absolutely. Yes.
I think if you're asking about the budget on our project, it's confidential, but yes, it was a very unusual project. One doesn't get to work on those projects very often, where. An individual client is very closely involved working with the architect, placing very high demands on the quality of the design, and then talking about money. and I know that's a very unusual situation, but I can think of analogous situations when we started our practice and worked on very small houses where you get a client who's so enthusiastic, then they want to understand the potential before they fix everything, so that they can understand where the money's distributed. So Damien Hirst is a brilliant client because he was very brave.
Okay, well, as you said, all projects have budget. There's two projects that were perhaps on the more obviously budget-driven. One is the housing, Philip, and the other is the college. Do you want to, Philip, do you want to give us a quick insight on how tough our friendly developer, contractor, Lendlease are to work with, delivering affordable and private housing into a complex world of consultation and outturn costs and sale?
So Lendlease are the developer, but they're also Bovis Lendlease, so they deliver. So the whole affordability criteria of the design was probably started before or put into place before we'd even put pen to paper. So every stage throughout the journey, they were managing the costs and keeping us on a steady keel, moving in the right direction. But in no time did they share the actual budget with us. But
that's because you're on a percentage fee. Brendan, do you want to?
Well, I'm going to tell you what the cost of our building was. We would not have won this project if we were not the cheapest. We also wouldn't have won the project if it wasn't the best as well. The project cost, I think it was about £2,200 a square metre. I don't know what the equivalent cost for a college would be down here, but that up there was very, very good value for money. And it was also done in a very, very fast time. We went through that bid process, and it also had to be as efficient as possible. We had to make it as small as possible, but large enough to satisfy the very detailed client's brief. So we had to work very hard to try and create a building of the quality that we did within the very limited budget. So we had to rely on the forms of the building, the shapes, the spaces, the interaction. And yes, if we had more money, yeah, we would have maybe done things slightly differently. We would have probably had a better quality of finishes and a better quality of detailing of the places. But hopefully what you saw tonight, we actually created a building which does actually have a quality that you wouldn't normally get in a cheap design and build project.
Asker, you began the evening and you worked on a building that's to study government. It's an international building. Your practice works all over the world. Is there any difference really in the pressures you experience from that kind of project to a Laban, to a museum in San Francisco? Is it just another of the many constants that inform, or was the patronage of your client overwhelming you with money to spend on your project?
No, it wasn't.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think you can also see that, every project has a budget, it was said before, and sometimes it's a little bit more generous and sometimes a little bit tighter. We work on very tight budgets and very generous budgets, but you always have to work with the budget and you always have to value engineer and you always have to cut down costs, no matter how big the budget is. So it's always a struggle. It's a little bit the same thing. I don't like that question so much because it's really like you work with the budget. I mean, somebody has said that before, and it's part of the brief. You get a program brief, you get a site, and you get a budget, and you make it work.
Would there be a view there that, in some senses, certain projects look only at outturn costs, other projects are engaged in a longer conversation about the value of making a place over time? And that, to me, is the change. Budget is an invention that we sign off with a contractor. There's another thing about actually, the long-term value is really
what's the investment in the future, in the community, in the place, and all that. I think that is exactly the point. That is much more important at the end of the day. But yeah, so I think it's a little bit the same. I was just about to say that with the challenges. What are the biggest challenges? It's such a great question. Like the budget. What's the budget? What's the challenge? Every project is full of challenges. I think architecture is only about challenge. I mean, I don't know one single project where it's just a smooth flight. It's just not possible. And that makes really the architecture alive. I mean, I think creativity and great buildings are born out of challenges, about restrictions. And budget is just one of them.
Yes, so you could really say we are trained to create our own challenges within a project. Whatever the budget, if you take the Getty building, Maya...
Challenges are created for us. We have to work with them and we have to solve them creatively. But I always find it much more easy to work with restrictions and within a straitjacket, let's say, and find the ways through it than with a blank canvas approach. I mean, very rarely we have that. For example, little bit south in the desert. You know, some clients come up with, you know, apparently no budget, no time limit, nothing, just an empty piece of land, a piece of sand. And then you have to say no, because it's what do you do? You know, you can. How do you start? How do you? What's the context? What's informing the project? And I think if nothing is there, then it's very difficult to do something.
Okay. Well, I mean,
I think I agree with that, and would add that you can use that as a generator of the architecture. So for us, for example, we knew that at some point there's going to be that horrible VE discussion when the contractor's surveyor comes and tells you to take stuff out. So we made the architecture out of the structure and the services, because you have to have them. So there was nothing left for the surveyor to take away. And we knew at the beginning of the process that by doing that, the quality would be invested in those materials.
Okay, well, I think Charles Eames said, without problems, there is no design. You've all had tremendous problems to face, but you've all actually responded to make these, you know, long journeys, 5, 6, 8, 10-year journeys, extraordinary journeys that you've been on with the project, but the site has been on before. It's engaged you all. It's been extraordinary. You're on another long journey. I think it's a month before the decision. There's probably another roadshow somewhere else. Thank you all seven speakers and Christine, for your time this evening, for your insights, for your generosity. And thank you, the audience, for your attendance. It's 9 o'clock. There is a bar. Let's shut now and go. Thank you all very much.